Hi everyone, and thank you for having us today. My name is Dr. Rat. I work with Dr. Bunchai. Today, basically, he will be the main one who talk. I basically just the one who click the slide. Okay, but if you are like Dr. Bunchai said, we are heavily inspired by what Dr. Alvin did yesterday, and we think it's very great. So. We decide to copy him to do the same thing. Yeah. So if you are ready, you can join in the slide like this, and we can proceed to our question.
Is it ready? Okay. At least our friend in the room are ready. Just if someone not ready, just tell us. We will. Wait another 2-3 minutes. For our friend in online, I think you see the slide, right? Okay. Is it okay? Are you? No.
Yeah, I think internet has some problem.
Yeah. Is it okay now? Okay. So 6639-1271. Then we can start. I think we can start.
All right. So the first question is, what is your existing health information exchange at the national level? So it's only in the national level, not in your local province or something smaller.
Interesting. I think we experience the same thing. The both reporting and claim data are the one that almost exchange in many countries because the money. Yeah. Money talk. No, you know, when we talk about business model, we as a clinician usually thinking about the clinical practice guideline. Or the information, they call the care model, something like that. But those care model, like you said, the hepatitis. Wow, you know, I think we have the same pain. We have a very little share the clinical and the. Like the clinical data for the continuity of care. Okay. I would like to know which country exchange the clinical, the US, right? Oh, the Malaysian. Yeah. Could you give more the example of what kind of the clinical or referral data that you exchange?
Like I mentioned, we just did our health information exchange national platform. So now we are piloting it in one state. We just went live on 29th of September, 2 weeks ago. So we use the FHIR standards and we have published the API. Like mentioned, API is important. So we exchange discharge summary, event summary, e-referrals, and many other things. We also exchange all the, because it's integrated with the blood bank system, we also exchange blood donation information. So, but what we did is we also created a person portal. So the people get to see their data. So to make them want it and demand for it. So that's how we have done it.
Okay. How is successful? Did you?
No, it just started 29 September. Okay. So maybe next year I'll present.
Okay. Marek and John, Can you share the situation in the US? Do you exchange the clinical data on that? Yeah. You know, most is reporting and claim.
Yeah. So we have laws basically that require all of the reporting to be done in FHIR now, and most of the major EMR providers are at least willing to be compliant with that. But we don't have health information exchange in the same way that like we think about in the context of OpenHIE. So you can't do continuity of care across patient encounters if it's outside of an insurance network. Within the insurance networks, the providers themselves have pretty good, many of them have good interoperability within their own networks, but we don't have good interoperability without. What we do have, and what the big push has been, is patient portals that allow patients to get access to their data, and you can then take the data yourself with you, which of course is not a great way to provide interoperability, but it does empower the patient to get access to that. So that's also regulated by law, and those systems are pretty well built out now. So if I visit a doctor, I can then see all of the notes from that, I can see all the referrals, everything, and I can download that myself. And so it's we don't have good interoperability in the US. Other than we do have requirements around FHIR, and we do have required reporting of minimal data back up to CDC.
Okay, thank you. Please. Anna, right?
Yes,
from Anna, yeah.
And also just on the US context.
The mic. Okay.
The US supports a FHIR profile called the US FHIR Core Standard, and then mandates that hospitals abide by this profile. So it's a way to have a country specific FHIR profile that is mandated across all the countries. I know Philippines has done work on a Philippines profile, and so it would be similar if the Philippine Ministry of Health was in mandating that all health hospital systems need to record their data in this format. So this specifies specific things like social security numbers that are unique to the national context.
Okay, thank you. Jai from India.
My example is not more on the national context, but on the institutional side. So from 2006, October, we have never printed any films in radiology. It has been completely online. So between our institutions, we do share all the scans, MRI, CT, ultrasound, those are all in DICOM. And then any patients, because we do a lot of referrals, like for example, somebody going for any oncology and they need these reports. These reports are actually given to them. Those days we used to write it in a CD with a DICOM viewer, so that anywhere they just insert on the drive, it automatically opens. Now, of course, we are doing it on a USB drive. But within our institutions, all radiology, lab referrals, discharge summaries, it's all actually available across. It's a web-based system, so they can schedule, order, and then view the results. It comes automatically, some clinician orders the test, they actually get an alert, and then the record is available to them. And then even the patient moves across our health system, it's available. So it's an institutionally, we are interoperable. Thank you.
Okay, Egbo, Dr. Egbo.
Mongolia is now in a transition period of digital health. And I would like to tell one story. When we visit to Estonia to study the Estonian experiences, and they say they actually divided the digital development for three categories. The one is the separated information system country. The second one is the integrated countries such as Estonia and other European countries. And third one is they say they personalized information digital systems, they said, and they are moving toward to this personalized information systems for persons. And now we are talking about only how to integrate our data and how to interoperate in our data. In our case, that we are in transition period of digital health, and now we are exchanging the discharge summary, and also using these PAC systems, we are send the image between hospitals. But I think the most important thing is we need to adopt this standard and based on the doctors and nurse needs. And after that, maybe we can easily do, it means like the information technologies is easy to handle the patient and doctor's needs.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Then the next one. we spent almost half an hour, so we will go a little bit faster on this.
I see. So just a recap a little bit. In Thailand, that we also have claim data, reporting data, and some of the clinical data. The claim data is we have three public health insurance, and reporting data we have something called 43 files that is exists for more than 20 years. It's more like a text-based reporting. And for clinical data, now the only national level project is the HealthLink project from the Ministry of ICT. They aim to be the national level, but in reality, it's around 100 hospital join in the project. Thank and each hospital join in different level. They use the IPS file profile to exchange. Yeah, but not all hospital can comply to the full extent of IPS. Some just send a part of IPS, some send a lot, something like that. And we also have some future projects that most of them use FHIR as a standard as well, but we doesn't have the national profile like in the US or other country yet. Yeah. So
next,
the next question is what are your current national health data standards that you are using in your country?
You can select more as many as that you have, please. You know, I use the Thailand context to list all of these standards, but I know that there is another standard that country are using, and we can see that several has identified national ID. This is good. We have this kind of web, a national ID and provider registry or ID in the facilities. And several level of the semantic SNOMED line, and it seems like the FHIR, the format or the structure of standard are now going. Anyone would like to comment on this this result? What is the trend in our region, the ASEAN? And it seems like it's all across the standard. We already implementing some standard, maybe in the piloting regional thing or the in the national level. So if not, then go to the next slide. Here, this is my approach. Actually, my approach proposal to many group that we use the open HIE architectures as the technical architectures, and this is all the application that we hope that it can be used with the component that we build once and then use many, and those box over there is the kind of the component of the standard that we should have, like the national ID, the facility ID, and also the semantic, the claim, the inventory or report. And this is a kind of the interoperability that we talking about the how we identify and authentication, and also about the mapping. And I consider HL7 FHIR that involve both what we call structural. It involve both data set and also the semantic side, the code set inside the FHIR. The red one is what we have in Thailand. And you can see that most is for the administrative or claim. The white box is what we are trying to do. And this is the way that I propose to the stakeholder, the country, that why don't we come and help setting out of all of this, and then we and all these two. So every application or every system should be used. So this is just the way that I interpret the integrated the architecture using the open HIE architecture with the standard. What we are, I mean, vision that should have. Over.
Thanks, Dr. Bunchai. Actually, about this slide, if we have time in the future, I would like to discuss more about the use of standard in your country as well. Because although maybe Thailand have used some of this in this slide, but the level of use or the quality is not that good. For example, the provider identifier, we have the identifier number of the people for the practitioner, but it doesn't update. It doesn't real time. It doesn't we know instantly which patient belong to which general practitioner, something like that. Or even procedure code, we use ICD-9-CM, which is not update anymore for many years. We plan to switch to something else. We don't sure yet which one we will switch to. Yeah, so if we have a chance, we would like to learn more from your country as well. So the next question is, which organization or mechanism in your country is responsible for health information standard?
Wow, Ministry of Health. And I believe that I think many of us is from the Ministry of Health, but my experience as a civil servant and in the Ministry of Health and after as a retiring and thing is very fragmented. It seems like the big organization in many countries. So some division don't talk to the another division, for example, in Thailand, we have the Health Policy and Management Bureau, and also have the Center of the ICT. Both are working with the information and IT, but we support that they should be integrated, but sometimes they compete on projects, and that I think might be you will be familiar with the Ministry of Health. I don't know, and some say that ICT, no science technology, but independent agency led. But the insurer, you can see that the insurance are more influencing on that. Any comments on this?
No.
Thank you. So do you think Ministry of Health should do this? Yeah.
Why is Ministry of ICT interested in health information standards and not Ministry of Health? That five people who answered.
not separately. It's sort of like we don't need to reinvent the wheel, right? So, say for example, information security. Ministry of Health need not actually get into that. Ministry Hello. Of ICT is responsible for that. For example, consent framework in India, like we just adopt from the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. So the Ministry of Health actually subscribes to that. Thank you.
Okay, Anis, yes, from Indonesia.
The same setting, I think, for the Ministry of ICT Indonesia. They should also responsible for the digital signature standard. This is also among the problem in Indonesia. Currently, we have only 7 organizations that has been approved by Ministry of ICT as the provider for digital signature. But there are 60,000 health facilities. So it is also among the problem on where the Ministry of ICT developed the standard and also to accredit the independent body for digital signature, for example. And also actually at the health facilities, we also depended on the independent or other standard. For example, medical devices. In Indonesia, the Ministry of Health actually developed the registration of medical devices. But currently medical devices coming to the users directly for the individual through marketplaces. And they use the GS1 standard, which is, I think, it is not well recognized by the Ministry of Health. So the problem, I think, if the Ministry of Health dedicated one unit specifically for standard, that will be improved and strengthen the communication within. But if it is still within the many directorates, we still have a problem.
I have one question to the group. Do you think the Ministry of Health have capacity to demand to kind of the say that it should be the health data standard for the country?
They have the power, but do not have the capacity.
Okay.
No, this is technically this standard things does not come in the capacity of health ministry. So it should be independent, because you know, keeping this standardization, most of countries have goals like as a frequency and broadband. This goes to information communication and technology, because this is more technical. This is more technical rather than the service. So that's why this should be outside Ministry of Health.
Okay, Avin.
Yeah, I we laughed at Anis when he said they have the power but they don't have the capacity, because in a way it's true. And that's why we need to go capacity building. We need to do digital health planning national systems. We need to do digital health planning local systems, because this is a big responsibility on the shoulders of government, on the Ministry of Health. And unless you have the capacity to use that power correctly, you will not be able to use that power. And if you don't use that power, it will be a mess. Yeah. It will be a mess, because there's no leadership that will tell the people, this is where we are going. The hospitals are really investing on technology right now, but everyone's investing on their own technology. Unless we have built the capacity of MOH for the power that they already have, because they're the elected people, they were elected by the people, we will not solve this problem.
Okay.
So we need to work together. We need the MOH to have the capacity to wield that power properly, and we need civil society to follow that power. So we need government, we need civil society. That's why we created this network, because we need to talk. If we don't meet about these things, we cannot second guess each other. So let's meet and let's just, you know,
I think
regularly
come to CP Wong. That you said the Hill and the IT and Rajendra also talking about that, but this is the finding in our research. Ministry of Health know the challenge of health, but they don't have all the span of the capacity to do the digital things. They know the clinical data, but technical like digital signatures, the security, something like that. How they handle those? And when we're talking about the interoperability, it's not just one layer. Is the technical layer, is structure layer, is the semantic layer, is syntactic layer, and business layer. It's five layer of the interoperability, but it seems like we only focus on the technical, but we as a health is on the data side and the business side. CB.
I think the crucial bit actually is not about ministry taking the lead, but it's the leadership, I think. That. In most countries, I think the Ministry of Health is tasked with service delivery. That means you deliver a service, you get funding, and so on. But when we migrate to the, what I call digital health, the technical becomes a big component. And the ministry may not have that budget or the capacity to build it, but we have to build the capacity, like what Alvin said. But the most important thing actually is to take leadership, because at the end of it, I think the outcome is important, and that is what Ministry of Health is doing, the outcome in the form of the welfare of the patient. So we have to take the leadership, and we have to collaborate and bring in the expertise. So I think collaboration is actually the norm.
Okay. You know, if you read the Broadband Commission report in 2017, 18 or something like that, they identified three factors that the country can success on developing digital health, e-health or health information system. One is the strong and continuous leadership that would be continuously focused on the building information system. The second thing is that they have to have the good mechanism of the governance. Good mechanism of the governance. And the third the third one is the standard that, they have to have someone to creating the standard. So you can go and read this kind of the report. Over.
Thank you, Dr. Bunchai. Because earlier I haven't joined Zoom, so I'm not sure. Are there any question from the before? I think if
any question from the Zoom side.
If no, if there are no, then okay. I will continue to the next one. So the next one is, what are the main challenges in developing health data standard in your country? So this question focus on the development, not the implementation yet.
We divide the health data standard into part, right? Developing and implementing. This question is about development. You can, what we mean by development, that maybe the adopting, adapting, creating yourself. Capacity, update, getting listen census. What is the challenge? Oh, why is it challenge? Oh, to the challenge of the, and the incentive to implement, lack of national strategy and enterprise architecture skill in maintenance is the dedicated team who build the cat. Which cat? I don't quite sure what does it mean. Please explain who is the cat. Approved process is taking so long, lack of desire, compliance and literacies, collaboration, capacity, interoperability, incentive, divergent interest.
In my screen and in the screen here is not the same.
Why?
I don't know. It is like it's already freeze the mouse. Yeah. But there is a lot of other
yes,
comments. You can read it. Please read it.
There is a lot actually. most of thing is the compliance and lack of understanding, collaboration, capacity building. One interesting one is that the standard published as a PDF that are ambiguous. Okay, it's already come here. Yeah.
Holistic cooperation and approach initiative emanate everywhere. Private sector researcher have system need pathway for initiative to convert together. We will collect all of these response, and you can see that it's a lot of a challenge, both in terms of the people, the collaboration, and also some technical, like the capacity to developing or learning or knowing the need of the know the need and also know have the knowledge to developing it. Dr. Fazila.
Yes, because I was involved before in a team that we created national standards. I also involved in setting up National Health Data Dictionary. It's very tough. But what I was thinking is, maybe it's very tough because we always want to do things ourselves and want to create for your own country. Why can't we follow the 80-20 rule, adopt that what's already done outside there at the international level, and then maybe only the 20% that needs to be localized, we localize. I think if we do that, then life is much easier.
Yeah, I actually, we use this principle. I can tell you the short story about the developing the Thai medicine terminology. We mandate that, how we identify the medical products and then they can use for the reimbursement. That is the mandate. What we do is that we don't developing from scratch. We look at the Australia, we look at UK, we look at the even the US. The US is the good example of not to do as the US. Because of at first, they have the NDC, National Drug Code, which is used for the business, something like that. But they cannot use the from the clinical. But they have a lot of legacy system. The e-prescription already used NDC. Then one, when they want to exchange the clinical data, they have to create another one called RX norm. And if you go and study the RX norm, it's quite complex. But that is the clinical part of the drug. We learn from that, and then we found that the UK and Australia, they use the concept model like the SNOMED modeling, and then they model over the SNOMED modeling model, and then we just go study it, and then not copy, but kind of the adapt that kind of the model, and then we can speak that the Thai medicine terminology can use for the reimbursement and also for user clinical. And we are vision that one day this coding system will be inside the EMR, and then it can use for the alert reminder or something like that, because of it's built in the relationship in that already. This is the sample that we do in developing what we do now. So the next step that we are going to do is SNOMEDization of the Thai medicine terminology. Okay, I agree with Dr. Fasila that we should do 80-20, adapt and adopt.
Thank you, Dr. Bunchai. I think for me personally, I have direct experience with two issues here. This one, the standard published as a PDF. I have created a fire profile for, and not I, I mean, I and my team, we create a fire profile for the driving certificate. If you have ever looked at the fire profile, it's a lot complex. Data structure things, but when the government that want us to do have to publish that profile, they have to publish as a PDF, and it end up like a 100-page of PDF that no one can understand what inside. So yeah, so this is one of the issue, and also this one, the standard themselves are not stable. We have created a file profile that need to use the resource that quite have the low maturity, and that have the risk. It means that in the next version of file, they can completely change, and yeah, that resource even may not exist anymore. So that is also the risk that we have to take. No one? Okay. Eco. Yeah.
Now.
So the next question is the last question is for challenge for developing, and this question is for implementing.
Oh, mandate it. Do you think mandate is this is very interesting. What I found is you can mandate it, but if there is no money, nothing happen. So that's why I said the three model should be designed together: the financing model, the clinical service model, and the information model. No, I mean the information system, the information model, the standard and something like that. That can, you have to have the minimal data set to serve that kind of the healthcare services. Like if you, in your case, it's hepatitis, the data that need for the hepatitis registry, the standard code set to identify those and the procedure, something like that. And also the business that if they comply to that clinical pathway, then they will give the money.
Can I interpret that there are three things? One, there should be a financial purpose, there's a clinical purpose, and there's a common information model that can address both purposes.
Yes. But I would like to say that to decide, sometimes the financing part, do you have, you just decide your business, and then I will decide my reimbursement, and they assume that the data at the hospital will serve them, but it is not. This is what my experience for over the year, that why I trying to experiencing or testing, experiment, getting three kind of the expert to come together and then thinking and decide together how this will serve the reimbursement and also serve the healthcare service model, but also the standard will be used for both. Okay. You can. What is the territorial behavior refusal to collaborate? Legacy system with large clientele and database on the order. So the legacy system, the financial, the donor, the DHIS too. Okay. The financial and human resource coordination and leadership. It's come to governance and people again. So you can see that all four components, the gaps, are interrelated. It's interdependent. It's not dependent for each other. You cannot have governance first and then they will mandate all of those. You have to have also the team to kind of the design the architecture and also the team to develop the standard. And also you have to have the people who have the capacity to do that. Dr. Alvin?
So Dr. Bucay, thank you for, it goes back really to governance and leadership. Yeah. And I think it's because we're like a big family. And the children have their own, you know, they want to do, one wants to watch a movie, the other wants to go out. And they're competing for candies or projects. Mm-hmm. So I think that's why we need governance, because the governance are the parents. They will be the ones to tell us, okay, I can hear all of you, but we can only do one thing with the money of the family. And this is how we're going to spend the money of the family. And it will not, you know, it will not satisfy all of the children. Some will complain that my parents have a favorite child, but that's the way it goes. You only have a limited amount of money in government, and you have to put it in the way the governance thinks it should be. Of course, government is not just a family. It's really a bureaucracy, and the decision making needs to be done by the people with a mandate to make that decision. I think they need to know that they need to make that decision, because they probably do not know what is this e-health all about. You did not tell me I got elected last June, but you did not tell me that I have some responsibility. So I think that's also, it behooves upon us to inform the new board that they have a responsibility to give us directions. Thank you.
You know, 8-9 years ago, I just jealous Philippines that they can create the governance mechanisms and support by the high level, and they go smoothly. But once the leadership change, then the situation change. And in the report, and even my research, this is the weakness of the Ministry of Health model mechanism. That's why the independent agency stronger in this part, but very weak on the authorization. So we have to choose for your country which one is the good way to go on the spectrum of the governance. Dr. Fazila?
This one, I'm just taking a comment from the chat. There's a comment from Dr. Nora Azaria from Malaysia. Will too many standards restrict innovation? And where and how to find the balance between having necessary standards and allowing room to innovate? To you, Bunchan.
You know, this is the basic argument between setting the standard and the innovation. To me, I think it's not conflict. If you remember, once they have the Android, that is kind of the standard, right? The innovation, burgeoning. It depends what you do by the standard. For the example, the standard of the road. When someone set the standard like the Roman wheel because of the space of the horse, then everyone use this kind of the space between the wheel. It this is the standard, and it can be kind of the getting for every cart can go to every road. It is not too narrow or not too big. So I think it come hand in hand. It to me is not stifling the innovation. Thinking about iOS, thinking about the Microsoft Windows, or even you maybe forgot that we can have internet now because of we have what protocol TCP/IP, right? If we don't have the standard of the TCP/IP, don't thinking about the internet. Okay, Rajendra.
Yes, I'm sorry. That's really very good idea about the TCP/IP. We should not have to strict in a one standard because technology have a interoperability capacity. You can interact different standard with the system. So there is no limitation. Even in TCP/IP and other, we don't have any limitations. We can communicate with different type of devices, different type of communication systems. And now we are going in a 5G or smart grid systems. So I think the one thing is, Fajila has already mentioned, and every country might have their different data set systems. And there is a one opportunity that we can work together. Let's make one dictionary that can be localized is for that. For the region, one dictionary. And you can bring from the, even it is, let's take the example as a ICD-10 or 11. ICD-10, 11 is a big dictionary. So you can bring whatever you need, you can bring it. So why not for data sets to make a regional dictionary and bring through the APIs, bring that those dictionary in your EMR system, in your DSIS2 systems, then everyone can work on that dictionary. If you need a Spanish language, or if you speak a French, or if you speak a Hindi, no matter. So the thing is, let's not limit. Unlimited standard can come in the systems, and they are interoperable.
Okay. Actually, we run out of the time, but we have kind of the question that would like you to respond. Let it go quickly to the next one. We have 3 minutes.
Right, so the next one is, should your country have a standard and interoperability lab? Yes or no? Or if you already have, should we destroy it too?
yeah, just destroy it. And use the authority or for not, to me, I think standard and interoperability lab is more sandbox, right? Sandbox, right? Is the experimental, something like that. And we maybe use this kind of the sandbox as the spear to come to go to the interoperability and standard. What Dr. Lat mean destroy is that we go to the point that we can get it out of the lab and then scale across the country, institutionalize it. Yeah, we don't need the sandbox anymore. We can institutionalize it. Right? I don't know.
I'm not sure.
And anyone that answered the no, could you come out and explain or just elaborate what do you mean by no? No. You know, even you said no, maybe you are listening. Then come to us that we should destroy seal in the first place. If you have another kind of the alternative that we should do, let's go to another question. But it seems like we are going to have the sandbox, right? The standard and interoperability lab. So after this, if someone would like to discuss more on the community of standard and interoperability, we can do working together on that.
There will be a breakout group on that.
Yeah. After we have a 15-minute break, right?
Okay.
I think because we run out of time, so let's skip to the last question. This one. How should we collaborate at the regional level?
What we mean regional level is in our AHIN communities. Let's thinking about our regional first. After reach out to Africa, Latin American, something like that, how we as the South and South Asian country to do together. Oh, yes, good. So working with AHIN and in the business meeting, don't forget to elect Fasila to be the chair. Share knowledge, share tip and trick, share failure. So is the sharing, which is the policy, the philosophy or the spirit of the AHIN. I like Arvin always said that we share scar. I think we are the warrior on the digital health and health IT. Then we have a lot of scar. Then why don't we share our scar to our friends, and then they will know how to not to do. And I learned a lot when I study in the US what not to do as the US.
How many years did you stay in the US?
7 years. So that I think to me the US is the best innovate. There is a lot of solution that you can learn, but because of it's a big country, a rich country, and have a lot of legacy system, that's why it's very difficult to kind of the good, right, Marik? You know, you will learn a lot when you go to see the innovate in the US and the UK, the Australia. There is a lot of innovation and the best idea that we can learn, and then we can adapt and adopt to our. And the good thing for us, the lower middle income country, that we don't have too many legacy system. So we can start fresh and leapfrog from what we learn from the developed country. Okay, I will read out the network to network convergence. Share your passion and experience. Show the digital health can be led not only by techie but also senior health leader. Share artifact library through common workshop and meet up through the event like AHIN, joint project, sharing transparent manner, regular side-by-side comparison, implementation, standard, learning. You see, it always about sharing and peer-to-peer learning. So I think we already run off the time, right? And this is just the advertising. Do you want another three group to advertise their marketplace. I can take 1 minute advertise my marketplace. So if you want to know about the Seal Thailand current project that we will get the benefit that the doctor one doctor in our in the university become the president of the National Broadcasting and Telecommunication Commission. We are proposing to that doctor, and that doctor buy our idea that the project that we are going to develop in the next 5 years. And if you want to learn, then come to the standard and interoperability COI, the community.
So I think from the data warehousing and open data marketplace, I mean, we can share a little bit about what we've done over the several years on how to actually be able to generate structured data from various data sources, and also how we share the data and make it available for researchers, also the general public, to generate health value as well as to improve patient care.
Okay, thank you. Anis.
Currently, the Digital Transformation Office developed a new product called the Dictionary of Pharmacy and Medical Devices. Mm-hmm. And for the pharmacy, we adopt the several standard, for example, on drugs, and then trying to use this standard to be adopted by health facilities. But among the challenges is actually on the medical devices. We need to learn from other countries what are the standard for medical devices, and we would like also to learn about how to streamlining the process on collecting the medical devices data, especially on health facilities, because it is different to drug. Medical devices could be recorded as an asset. So if the health facilities at the district level, they should report this asset to the local government and also to the accountancy system. So still, currently, we still have the problem on recording this kind of asset. So for example, if a bed in the hospital at the Ministry of Health Affairs, it is categorized as furniture, not as medical devices. So this kind of standard, I think we have not yet discussed in detail, but in the health system, among the biggest spending is actually on the medical devices. Thank you.
Okay.
For the Philippines, later on, we'll be presenting the National eHealth Program on how the country has developed or established the National eHealth Program, its importance, and its accomplishments for over the years.
Okay. So we will have a 15-minute break.
A big hand to Dr. Bunchai and Dr. Rath.